Behavioral health services is such a critical part of overall health.
Within family medicine, a large percentage of patients come in with medical problems that put them at risk for behavioral diagnosis like depression.
Depression is the number one complication of childbirth.
The numbers of children that have unmet behavioral and developmental needs is staggering.
We know there's an unmet need in our community. Let's go ahead and address it.
There's a lot of energy around integrated care, and I think there's a lot of good reasons to believe that sort of reconnecting the mind and the body and caring for them as one is going to lead to better outcomes.
It offers way more seamless service. It gives me an opportunity to always have the physicians in the office. We can consult, they know the families, I know the families, and we come together and we just provide a much better service to the families.
I mean, I love practicing this way because I have the doctors as a resource.
The longer we work together, the more expert we each get at what the other one does.
In terms of having their medical record, you have so much more context and you have a team to work with.
So what it's allowed me to do is see patients more efficiently and see them more effectively.
We're able to reduce a lot of barriers to care.
You can't tell looking at our patients in the waiting room who's here to see whom. So I think the stigma goes completely away. It's a godsend.
We really have an opportunity for constant collaboration, feeling like we're really a true member of the medical team.
There's that capacity that gets built. Yeah. And that comfort level that comes from practicing together.
We raise each other's skill set.
We need psychologists in private practice. We need psychologists working in mental health clinics to be able to care for our patients. But we also need psychologists in primary care settings.
It's a great model. I can't think of doing psychology outside of the model that we do it here, in an integrated care model.
I could not imagine nor want to practice in any other way.
This is just good preventive health. It's good health care. Most importantly, it's what we ought to be doing.
You know, it takes a village to raise children. Well, they're part of my village.
I could not have dreamed 10 years ago that we'd be showing that at State Leadership Convention. It makes my heart sore. And I could stand up here and talk about integrated primary care all day long. Truly, I could. People who know me know that's true. That said, I was actually asked to take a 10,000 square foot view of where we are and where we want to go. So tomorrow I have a panel. I'll talk all day long about integrated primary care. And anybody here who has a question about it or wants to learn more about it, bring it on. I would love to talk about it. But you guys are our leaders. I am so, and it sounds cheesy, but I'm honored to talk to you guys today. Because all of you guys are the movers and shakers in our field. Your peers have selected you as the people to represent them. And those of you that are watching from home, you're giving up a Saturday afternoon to watch this. So something tells me you're a little engaged in this process too. And I think that's fabulous. So where I want to start us off at is where do we want to go from here? Because what we do today, what we talk about today, really sets the stage for where we're going to end up tomorrow. So when the State Leadership Conference folks, the practice organization, put this together, they did kind of a little bit of a needs assessment. For you as participants, what are your pain points? What's on your mind? And what we heard from folks is we're very worried about getting reimbursed for the services that we provide. Insurance reimbursement and competition from non-doctoral and other providers is a huge concern. And I'm just curious, how many of you get asked on a regular basis what you're doing about this? Raise your hand. Okay, the lights are bright. I'm going to assume there were hand raises, all right? But I think that this is kind of when we look at ourselves and we look at what our needs are, that's a very high-level thing that we think about and that's very salient. The Center for Workforce Studies in APA did a really interesting different kind of needs assessment. So they looked at all the online ads for psychologists, so specifically said psychologists in the ask, and they looked at the skill sets that were being requested. And take a minute and look at this because it's research, communication, management, and so on. You don't see direct service here so much. I see head nods. That makes me really happy. I was afraid there might be rotten fruit. I was ready to dodge, you know. But the bottom line is the definition of who we are is changing. And there's really a disconnect. Don't know how that happened. There's really a disconnect in our focus on direct clinical service and getting paid for it and the way the rest of the world is seeing us. So the rest of the world is seeing us as perhaps supervising that, or creating the systems, or evaluating the systems. Now, I want to be really clear. I'm not saying throw out the baby with the bathwater. We still have to fight for appropriate reimbursement for services. But I think we also have to expand the dialogue into being clear that we bring other things to the table. So as we look out in the room, I see this wonderful variety of ages of people. And so, you know, for folks in their late career, I think it's safe to say, particularly given that this healthcare reform bus is moving kind of slow in some ways, that it's probably going to be okay for folks late in their career to continue to practice the way they practice. There may not be a huge need for change. For mid-career people, there's probably going to be a significant part of how they earn their living that is direct service, if that's what they want. But what I'm hearing from my peers, I like to pretend I'm mid-career, is that they're having to be a little bit of a niche practice. They're having to find some need in the community that they and only they can meet. And they're having to diversify. Oftentimes, being in private practice alone is not enough. They might be working for someone. And coming from family medicine, I will tell you that physicians and other healthcare professionals are finding the same thing. There is a huge push right now for healthcare professionals to be working in interdisciplinary teams and to be working together, not siloed out in their individual private practices. So this isn't just happening to us, this is happening across the board. But I think as we look forward, we owe it to our early career folks and the folks in training now, which I'm thrilled to see we have graduate students here, to really try to help them think about what else might they do other than direct service, okay? Where are the diverse settings where our skill sets are going to be needed? And how do we make sure training and expectations are set such that people know how to do those different things? They're prepared for that different landscape. And again, that doesn't mean they're not going to provide direct clinical service. It may just not be the core thing that they do all the time. No one knows for sure. And I'm aware of the whole sky is falling thing. People have been hearing for a long time that things are changing. But I do think that there's no harm in being prepared for things to be a little bit different. And actually, as far as I'm concerned, I think it's a really exciting time. So, you know, the old may you live in interesting times curse, I think we're living that in spades right now, right? But when you think about what do we as psychologists bring to the table, we know how to impact behavior. We know how to improve communication. We know how to help people with their relationships, okay? So at first, at one point, I had a slide about all the problems of the world, climate change, and you know, all that's relevant to that too. But because I'm a health psychologist, I'm gonna focus in on these health-related things. So first of all, we know that health behavior and poor lifestyle choices are the key element in changing the health of our country. Because we don't take good care of our bodies, and our environment is not set up to help us take good care of our bodies. And we as psychologists can help people, A, connect those dots, and B, work on changing those habits, and help parents establish more healthy habits from very early on. One of the things that I'm incredibly excited about, and just work with me here, because when I first say this, you're gonna think I'm nuts, but how many people here knew that the big retail pharmacies, Walmart, CVS, Walgreens, wherever you live, everybody has their own, how many of you knew that they are working very, very, very hard to become primary care providers? They are training their pharmacists to come out from behind the counter and talk to patients, to teach them health behaviors, to teach them how to take their medicines. They want to change who they are in their role. Now, obviously, there's a lot of financial drive in that. But I think pharmacy could teach us in psychology some really interesting lessons, because they've been pretty smart how they've gone about transitioning who they are in the healthcare field. It wasn't that long ago that they felt the same way we did, that they were kind of knocking on the door. So if we want to figure out how to get to that table, and I think we're much more at that table now than we were not that long ago, we can look to what they've done. I also think that these companies would probably love to pick up what we're putting down, because they want their professionals to know how to get people to be more successful. Because those patients will come back to that pharmacy, and oh, by the way, while they're there, they're gonna pick up a lot of other stuff. Who here has not walked out of a CVS or a Walgreens like 10 bags when you went in for one thing? That's their ultimate goal, but at the end of the day, when I think about it, I think, you know, how cool is it? How many people who have diabetes walk through a Walmart in a given day? How cool would it be if we as psychologists worked with that company and said, hey, we can help you not only help people be more successful in managing their health, buy their medicines and so on. But let's talk about having in-store food exams. Let's talk about how you set up a display to help somebody pick healthy foods. There's so much opportunity there, and that's but one of many, many different examples I could give. Another one, and this one's difficult, but we really have to look at how we handle end of life. It is not sustainable the way we're doing it right now. And if we look at why is it the way it is, a lot of times it has to do with relationships and families and grief. And again, we as psychologists have a skill set to bring to bear there to change the standard of care. Because people are oftentimes, unfortunately, huge amounts of money are being spent in those last few days really to no avail and in ways that ultimately make it harder for the families to move on and cope. So I see all kinds of opportunity. And like I said, I could talk about primary care all day long. And I think I'm aware there's probably some people in the room who are sick of hearing about primary care. Maybe you're not seeing it happen in your state. I live in northern New Jersey. I call it the land healthcare forgot because it's not happening so much in northern New Jersey. And I heard chuckles. Maybe that was probably the New Jersey table. It's really spotty across the country, but it's definitely burgeoning and growing, and again, a place for opportunity. So we have some answers that the rest of the world needs, but only if we're flexible about how, where, and with whom we provide those services. Everybody loves cats, right? I mean, you can never go wrong with a cat picture. And we have to focus on who we serve outside, not what we need, okay? And it's a both and. We've got to pay attention to getting reimbursed. But I think our strategy sometimes has been to just tell people how awesome we are. And I think our strategy needs to be that we get in there and we show people how awesome we are. So you guys as state leaders have a lot of opportunities over your next year or two, whatever your time is. And these are but a few ways that you can begin to change the dialogue. Because I think that part of the problem right now is, as a state leader, you're held accountable for this whole reimbursement thing. That's kind of what we end up focusing on. And we really need to start changing the dialogue and expanding it. And again, tomorrow in the panel I'm on, I'll go a little deeper into these. So my takeaway, I taught sleep-deprived residents for a really long time, so I'm a big believer in like having one thing you hope people remember. The world needs psychology, but not just in 50-minute increments. Thank you so much. Thank you.